next in Song of Norway.
Are you by any chance Mr. Engström?
Yes.
Oh, I was on my way to see you. I'm Edward Grieg. It's about the grant, sir.
I'm sorry, Grieg. I'm on my way to the festival. I'm late now and have to catch the ship at Bakka.
There is no opportunity for a composer here in Norway. My whole future lies in getting to Rome.
Well, to be quite frank with you, Grieg, I reviewed the compositions you submitted and simply didn't feel they warranted the society giving you the grant. It's as simple as that. The father's reputed to have been merchant. Where does he give you the money?
Father's had some financial reverses. He put up all the money he could afford when he sent me to the Leipzig Conservatory.
And as they're both going to the Leipzig Conservatory, makes him out of Beethoven, Mozart, perhaps even Bach.
Not at all, sir.
I'm relieved to hear that.
Now, if you'll pardon me, sir, what you just said is the narrow outlook of a bigoted man.
And you're being rather insolent. for someone who comes around here looking for charity. Good day, Mr. Greek. Will you please leave me alone, Greek?
You may control the music society, sir, but you don't own the road.
I'm taking the next ship home.
But you can't miss the festival. You're halfway there now. Come on. If you hurry, you could still catch this boat. Come on with us. It'll be fun.
Good idea.
We'll have to hurry.
You're not taking the ship.
I'm afraid I am.
I'm warning you, Greek. If you do, I'll have you arrested the minute we talk in Geranga.
I'll take you to Geranga, please. Hurry up.
Hurry, hurry!
Please, hurry up, please. Thank you.
Oh, Edward, I was afraid you weren't going to make it.
Well, so was I.
Oh, hello, Mr. Engston. My goodness, you're wet. Did you get caught in a shower?
You know this man.
Why?
Remember what I told you, young man. I meant it. Now, if you excuse me.
Is your father with you?
No, he's in Geranga at the festival. I want you to meet a friend of mine, Magdalene Torres, from the playwright.
How do you do?
Edward Green.
How do you do?
Edward and I studied piano together at the Leipzig Conservatory. Magdalena has a special soft spot for young budding musicians like yourself. She's helped more than one get started.
Does your father know Engstrand well?
Oh, yes. They're old friends.
How unfortunate.
Star is the life of a wife of a sailor. Star is the life of a sea spouse. Marry a clerk or a cook or a tailor. Marry the keeper of an ale house.
Star is the life of a wife of a sailor. Star is the life of a homebird.
Marry a butcher, a barber, a tailor. Marry a groom or a goldsmith.
Sail to the eastward, sail to the westward, sail to the southward, he'll never home.
Girls to the eastward, girls to the westward, girls to the southward, he'll never come. Watching and waiting,
watching and waiting,
waiting and watching,
waiting and watching,
watching,
waiting,
watching,
waiting,
waiting, waiting, waiting, waiting.
Waiting,
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 watching,
waiting, watching,
watching,
waiting,
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 waiting, waiting, waiting.
star is the life of a wife of a sailor. You'll be a one out of 20. Waiting, waiting for his kisses, while his kisses blend.
Engstrand has persuaded the captain not to allow you ashore. Not until he returns. With a police officer.
With a police officer? What in heaven's name for?
To arrest Edvard, I believe.
What do we do?
Divert their attention. Run.
Perhaps you'd better accompany me. And perhaps I should... Perhaps I should better accompany you. Let's carry on, young man. Come back.
John Eggstrom, John Eggstrom, we come to you full speed.
With a tarot, tiddle, and a rum tum tum.
And a very, very monetary need.
John Hagenstrom, John Hagenstrom.
Upon our speed, his feet we come.
But, sir, Lottie's not so young. Why are we getting there so fast?
A poor composer's plight to plead.
Oh, what a composer.
You see?
Father, I want to invite Edward to our party on the 10th.
To play for our guests?
Yes, why not?
Why not?
I don't understand.
She knows perfectly well why not.
You don't believe Edward is good enough?
Do you think that our guests, who are used to hearing artists like Jenny Lind, can be imposed on by a second-rate pianist?
And who says Edward is second-rate?
I do, for one.
And Mr. Engstrand, for another.
He was here?
He may return at any second.
Oh.
Do you know that your friend Greed very nearly killed poor Mr. Engstrand?
Nonsense. I don't believe it.
I'm not going to have that lunatic in my house.
Maybe this is a good time to disappear.
Yes.
Tell me that Engstrand was still dragging that officer with him.
No, he was quite alone.
When it comes to music, the Norwegians have no opinion of their own. If your musicians haven't made a reputation in another country, he's a nobody.
Ready for this fiddle, we'll keep it up until we get him steady in the middle. From where it's there, ready and his fiddle are ready in the square.
Do is to get a reputation.
Yes.
Isn't it time you were making your debut as a concert pianist?
Well, in Berg and I would draw him on a staggering audience.
Hmm?
12 people, all main group.
Oh. returning to Sweden in a few days. When will I see you again?
I don't know.
I only wish there was some way I could help you get started.
Well, you tried to introduce me to Mr. Engström.
The truth of it is, Edward, there wasn't any Mr. Engström. The man I referred to was my father.
Your father?
He's holding a music hall on July the 10th. He's invited you as a house guest. It will be a distinguished gathering. He wants you to play for them.
Oh, that's marvelous.
Yes.
I have wonderful news. Captain Hansen accepted our invitation. He'll be here tonight.
Oh, that is good news.
Captain Hansen is a fine, eligible young man. His uncle is Count Leduc.
My heart flutters.
Now, your father is quite determined you should marry well, Teresa. You could not find a better choice.
Excuse me, miss. There is a young gentleman to see you. Mr. Edward Grieg. He is expecting to stay the night.
Just a moment. You invited Grieg here despite my forbidding it?
I live here too, Father.
I'm surprised that an impecunious musician such as your friend can raise the money to even get here.
I advanced the fare to Edward.
In my day, no self-respecting young man would dream
of taking money from a young woman. Nor would Edward. I told him the money came from Father. He must continue to think that.
Teresa!
Who is this Edward Grieg, anyway?
Oh, a rambunctious second-rate pianist. According to Engstrand, he can't hold a candle to Teresa. A fact which I might turn to my advantage. For once, my headstrong daughter is going to regret her willfulness. Oh, I'm so glad you could come. Welcome to my house.
Thank you.
I hope you had enough money. If you want any more, do let me know.
Brilliantly.
Thank you, Captain
Hansen. What was it called?
On the Mountain. And the composer's right here.
You're wonderful.
No, it was the piece that was wonderful. You will now hear another one of Mr. Grieg's compositions, his lovely Nocturne. And this time, Mr. Grieg will honor us by playing it himself.
Thank you.
that was a cruel and inhuman thing you did to Edward last night. I'll never forgive you for it.
Such a lovely morning. I think I shall take my coffee out on the terrace. My dear, our guests are accustomed to hear only the finest artists in this house. You can't expect them not to be bored when they have to listen to some mediocre pianist who hasn't even got half your talent.
Father, you put them up to it.
Oh, nonsense, dear. Nothing of the kind. Now, I've much more important matters to discuss with you, my dear. The parents of Captain Hansen have invited you to spend a fortnight with them at their summer home at Medleybrunn.
Oh, how kind of them.
The king has a summer palace nearby.
Has he?
Yes, and Hansen's a great friend of royalty. You might even meet the king and queen.
Oh, how exciting.
Yeah, I said you'd leave this morning on the same train as Captain Hansen.
While Edward goes slinking back to Norway, licking his wounds. I'm sorry, Father. I'm not.
Now listen, dear. This is one time when you're not going to get your own way. I have no intention of allowing greed to hang around this house while you become even more infatuated with him than you are at present.
You can't force either Edward or me to leave Karlshamn. But I might be persuaded.
If I arrange the recital. Is that it?
I tell you what, Father. I'll go to Medleybrunn. Stay the fortnight, courtesy before the queen. Be a model of decorum. I assure you no one will be reminded by my behavior that your fortune was made by selling bottled punch.
I don't want the recital put on in my name.
And Edward wouldn't give it if you did.
Perhaps we could borrow the name of Mayor.
Why not?
Now, understand, you're not to return till the concert's over. You're never to write to him or see the fellow again.
Never see him again? Not even write him?
Those are my terms. Well?
The song I've just written is dedicated to you.
Oh, how nice. May I hear it?
Soft breeze, whispering trees, the summer winds are sighing, the leaves are lullabying. Violins are all around you. I can hear the corporate sound of bounding brass that seems to say, I've found you. I've found you. I've found you. Only now, as you spoke, did it start. Strange music of the spheres. Could its lovely hum be coming from my heart? You appear, and I hear some sublime song that I'm incapable of. So, dear, let me hold you near while we treasure every measure so that time can never change the strain. New music.
of love.
That was wonderful. You must play that as an encore.
Play it well.
I was so taken with your song, I forgot to tell you. Mayor Seastrom liked your playing so much that he's arranging a recital for you right here in our town hall.
Do you mean that?
Yes.
Well, how about? Maybe you'd help me decide on the program.
No, I can't. I won't be here. I'm leaving for Mirvibrunn within an hour.
She didn't even write to me. Or answer my letters. Why didn't she come back for the recital?
Edvard, I'm afraid you're going to have to forget Teresa. The families are already arranging their marriage.
Captain Hansen.
At least let me read the review of your performance. Mr. Edvard Grieg, the young, unassuming artist, gained well-deserved applause for his beautiful rendering, particularly of Schumann's Kreisleriana.
The critic was very kind.
Come sit down, Edvard.
Now, I want to help you. It was most unfortunate you're losing out on the grant to go to Rome. I admit that. But could you manage Denmark?
Well, I do have an aunt who lives in Elsinore. I think she would take me in for a while. Why?
Good. I have important connections in Copenhagen, one being Scandinavia's most distinguished composer.
Oh, you mean Garde?
Exactly. And he could be very helpful if he thought you showed talent.
Well, as a matter of fact, I've just completed a new composition. Humoresques for the piano.
This is trash, Grieg. Go home and write something better.
I need some fresh air.
Magdalene!
It's Ricard Nordrak.
Magdalene, hello there!
He's a fellow countryman of yours. You must know him.
The composer of our national anthem.
Ricard, how nice to see you.
Nice to see you, too.
Perhaps you're just the medicine Edvard needs. He seems depressed about his career.
Oh, wait a minute, Grieg. I'm up against the same idiots you are. Men who know as much about music as a can of mustard. Damn it all, Grieg. Our country must have music of its own. How can you and I find any inspiration in composing purely Norwegian music if we have to follow the style of the German classicists to please the critics? And what are we supposed to do? Follow these German composers like puppy dogs?
Excuse me, gentlemen, but the restaurant is only open at nighttime.
Splendid. Two beers. Two beers?
Oh, I must admit, Norak, that I was beginning to lose any hope of ever being important.
But you will be. And so will I.
We of the North will hear our notes echoed from the rest of the world.
Sing the silent snow.
sing the wintry seas, sing throngs of trees swarming up the hill, clothed in glittering garb of frost-formed diamonds. Sing on, a forest and a fjord made a milky and mystic land by winter's wizard hand. Tall ice cathedrals, crystal colonnades, vast sprawling mountains neath snow-white brocades, like giants fast asleep. Sing how of a sudden the wayward sun, repenting his southward flight, returns to flood the land with springtide. Once more the earth grows green, the hillsides shed their ermine mantle. Once more the birds are seen, and buttercups go blithely dancing. Iris grow, streams o'erflow, towering above them, the mountain top still crowned with snow. Sing the foaming creek, ah, sing the snowy peak, sing Norway. Lambs leaping free, sweeping through the glades, water tumbling down a thousand thundering cascades, as purple hues of summer turn to autumn's burnished shades. Yes, minstrel, sing and let your voice not die. The grandeur of glacier, fjord, and sky inform an unknowing world what we know well, that the land of the hard, cold north has warm delights and soft mysteries to tell. And then, minstrel, you will have made a true song, the song of Norway, whose music will ever enshrine
idealist, Nordrag. What's happened to Mrs. Thorison?
She left us, I guess.
Women are strange. She didn't even say goodbye.
Yes. Well, it's almost as if I'd written it myself. La la, la la, la la la, charming, delightful. Yes, it is. Edvard Grieg, you're a genius.
You know, you should have been a
poet.
You really think so?
Strange music in my ears. Only now, as you spoke, did it start. Strange music of the spheres. Could its lovely hum be coming?
Don't play that one. That's so beautiful. Oh, what are you doing?
I'm getting rid of all memories.
Oh, yes, I noticed it was dedicated to some girl.
Yes.
play these instead. A set of 15 songs I've written to the poems of Hans Christian Andersen.
15. Has Hans heard these?
I'm afraid not. I don't know him.
I know him. He's a very good friend of mine. Come on.
But these are songs. And they're written for a woman's voice. Nina Hargreaves' voice.
Who's Nina Hargreaves?
Oh, she's a cousin of mine. Well, I've been staying with an aunt for economic reasons.
Come on. Let's get the girl.
But she lives in Elsinore.
So?
Wait till you hear her voice.
How do you spell horse?
H-O-A-R-S-E.
No, it's H-O-R-S-E.
I wish I were a horse, then I wouldn't have to learn spelling.
Oh, well, horses have to learn to do things. They have to learn how to pull our wagons.
And I wish I was a dog.
Well, dogs have to learn to guard our houses. I'll tell you what, I'm going to take you into town with me, and then you can see that there is a reason for everybody and everything.
My father and brother make barrels. My brother is an apprentice shoemaker.
My two uncles are master engravers.
My father makes pins.
Every living thing must have a purpose on this earth. Each king or queen, each flea or fly. Every single being from the instant of its birth must seek its task, must ask its why. The wildflowers grow in throngs on the field, profusious but useless, or so we've heard.
Or so we've heard.
But this can't be so, for wildflowers yield sweet food for the bee and the hummingbird.
The hummingbird.
A rhyme and a reason, that's what we all must have. Do you have a rhyme and a reason? The brook babbles by, no wit nor no will, until it arrives at the old mill wheel.
The old mill wheel.
The brook turns the wheel turns the mill turns the grain into golden meal.
To golden meal.
A rhyme and a reason, that's what we all must find. Have you found your rhyme and your reason? The good baker's loaves the whole village buys. A most indispensable man is he. Though mice wait in droves to munch on his pies, the fat bakery cat handles that with glee. Are you doing something that makes you indispensable? Do you have a rhyme and a reason? The clockmaker keeps the town on the dot. No missing of trains or of school bells here.
Of school bells here.
And the glass blower's art, sublime is it not? His rhyme and his reason are crystal clear.
Crystal clear.
Far grave are the aims the apothecary claims. For chills and ills and disasters, pills and plasters.
Every living thing must have a purpose on this earth.
must earn its way, must prove its worth. Now
wild flowers grow
to feed bird and bee. The brook turns
the mill and the meal have we.
The good baker's
loaves.
The clockmaker's chimes.
The glass
blowers
crystal
are their life's
key.
And I, should you ask me, would tell you any time what is my reason for being. Darlings, you reason and the rhyme.
There we are. May I introduce the famous Norwegian
composer,
Richard Nordman.
How are you?
Edvard is convinced that Nina here is the only one who should sing his songs for Hans.
Hans?
Christian Andersen. He's a very dear friend of mine.
Can you come to Copenhagen with us?
Not to sing for Mr. Andersen.
Yes, why not?
Your aunt would never approve. Of course, you can ask her yourself. She'll be back in a few hours.
Well, we can't wait. We have to return to Copenhagen on the next train.
Well, anyway, Edvard, it would do you no good to talk to Mother. She's determined that I never appear professionally.
Oh, she wouldn't allow Nina to do anything which could whet her appetite.
Like merely singing for Hans?
What in heaven's name? Why not?
Well, you see, when Father died, Mother became an actress.
I was her leading man. That's how we met. I'm afraid my wife feels that being a professional entertainer is no life for a young girl. Huh?
There's no use talking about it anymore, Edvard. Mother's quite determined. Who'll help me get the coffee and cake?
I will. After you.
Oh, I must think of a way to help Edvard.
You're in love with Edvard, aren't you, Mina?
What makes you say that?
I don't know. You just feel these things, I guess.
I've been thinking. Twice a month, I go to Copenhagen for singing lessons. Carl Helsted is my teacher.
Carl Helsted? Mm-hmm. Wonderful fellow. Very dear friend of mine.
Well, Mother always goes to Copenhagen with me. But she spends the time shopping. That is, she usually does.
Ah.
Carl, so good to see you again. Here, let me introduce you to my old friend, Edvard Grieg.
Oh, you're pleased to meet you.
And you're Edgar Nordrag. Edgar Nordrag. Oh, yes, yes, of course.
Are you ready? Let's hurry.
Yes, Mother could be coming back any second. She was in a carriage just like that one coming up the street.
Keep a lookout. When I head her off, you two can slip out the front door.
Good luck.
Not Mother after all.
Good day, madam. May I help you from your carriage?
Oh,
gently now. Steady. There's
thank
a dear.
You.
You know, you really can get such a terrible sprain.
But
these
I'm going in there.
Madam, could you tell me the time?
It's 2:15.
Oh, thank you. Madam, can you point the way to the Tivoli Gardens? I know it's off in this direction here.
You go straight along here and...
There's another carriage coming up the street. This could be Mother's.
Nina, what about your list?
Now, let me see if I have this correctly. I go straight down here. I take the second...
Oh, it is your mother.
What'll we do?
Third turning to the left.
No, no, no. How many more times am I to explain? You go straight down here and you take the third turning to the right and the second turning to the left.
I think of something.
You know, that's locked, but I've lost the key.
Oh.
Come here. Come here. Behind here.
All right.
Would you mind going over it just one more time? I know you must think I'm a little dense.
Dense? I think you're the stupidest young man I ever met.
Now, where is Nina?
With some man, hiding behind a screen.
You go straight down here, and you take the third turning on the right. How many more times am I to explain? You go straight down here, and take the second turning on the left.
Well, I think I have it now. Thank you.
Gardens are over there.
Madam, I'm not going to the Tivoli Gardens. Hans, it's all good to see you. I want you to meet two old and very dear friends of mine, Nina Hagerup and Edvard Grieg.
Hello.
But, who? You remember me, Rickard. Nordrak.
Well, no, not really.
But you're at one of my concerts.
Still, I don't believe we actually met.
But you were there.
Well, now, Edvard has written some music to some of your poems. Come in.
Well,
excuse us, Mr.
Well.
Beside the wide and stormy sea, there stands a low and lonely house. No blade of grass, no flower fair, no tree does there abide. And yet this place is a pleasure dome, a fairyland palace in all but size. This humble house is a paradise, for love makes its home inside. No gold or silver will you find, no work of art behind these walls. But to whose treasure, whatever befalls, will last their lifelong span. A man who offers so much of warmth, a woman who lives for his touch of warmth. Oh, I know the house, for I am the woman, and my own dear love, the man.
Charming, charming. One hardly knows who deserves a greater credit. Mr. Grieg for his delightful composition, or Miss Hagerup for her lovely rendition.
Make way for the conquering trio.
All hail the unhalterable threesome.
A combination who can do all they say they'll do.
If the three stay together, come what may come.
Three bold and invincible Vikings.
Faced with a world that ignores them.
Its chilly ear they'll snare with a sweet Norwegian air. And a day will arrive when the world adores them. It's as though we stand on some high hill surveying the future that could be ours.
The bright, brave dream that we should fulfill spread before us in all their glory.
Whether we follow them together,
that will tell the ending of the story.
right the world and its wrongs if you are near me.
I'll sing such wonderful songs if you can hear me.
I will hear you.
Here on a hill of dreams, stand with your hand in mine. I see a horizon shining and clear when we're together.
I'll find my place in the sun with you to guide me.
I will guide you.
My darkest battle is won if you're beside me.
I'm beside you.
We're weaving a million schemes. Here high on a hill of dreams. Soon we'll bring them all.
May live only a few days, possibly a few months, not more, I fear.
Can nothing be done, boy?
Yes. This is no time to cross your father.
Water to 50 down from Edwy Brun makes me very proud of you, Therese.
I think they like you, Father.
From what I hear, Captain Hansen more than likes you. If he proposes, you'll accept, of course.
I don't know.
Therese, you and I have vied with each other ever since you were a little girl.
Marvelous. Keep going.
Hello. No, I don't want anyone to hear this till it's finished.
Oh, I have a letter for you. Came to my house.
A letter?
Something wrong?
You remember I talked about a Therese Berg?
Yes, I remember. A Swedish girl.
This is an announcement of her engagement to Captain Hansen.
Well, now you can forget about it. Once and for all.
I did that some time ago. Mm.
I wonder.
I'm meeting Nina in Elsinore tomorrow. After all, no woman ever lived who can sing my songs like her.
put the music in a little of Anderson's poem.
Oh.
I wrote it for you. Where can I find the piano?
Don't you even say hello. It's nice weather. How have you been?
I'm sorry, but I want to hear you sing it.
Oh, and I want to hear it. Come on, I know a place where we can find an organ.
Fine.
My mind is yours. There lives no other thought there. You all my heart can hold, or eyes can see. Were I in heaven, you'd be all I sought there. I cherish you, I worship you, I love you. With the very breath of me, I love you now and will eternally. My years of asking, balm to the qualms and fears that used to be. Warm golden light where in my soul is basking, I live for you. I love you more than life you see. I love you now and for
I'll get married.
Oh, how marvelous. And just how do you expect to support a wife?
Well, Edvard has obtained the post of conductor at the Christiania Theatre.
Oh, no, really?
Yes. Well, you see, the post is open, and, well, Rickard has written to the managing director, Mr. Bjornson.
Bjornson, the playwright?
He's my cousin.
Mm-hmm. As far as I recall, Carl Helsted was also one of your dearest friends. He never heard of you.
Well, Carl's getting on, you know. Mm. His mind is a little hazy.
Mm.
No, Bjornson really is Nora's cousin. In fact, Rickard wrote our national anthem, and Bjornson the word.
My cousin will do anything I ask him to. I could twist him around my little finger.
Then I suggest, Mr. Nordroth, that you twist him around your little finger before Edvard makes any further suggestions about marriage.
I think I have something to say about this, Mother.
If you even consider accepting Edvard on such a shaky prospect as this, you have to be completely reckless, completely mad.
Nina, I want you to come with me to Copenhagen, and we'll get married in the morning.
If you believe in all these promises about a conductorship, God help you.
Let God help you, Mother. Edvard will help me.
I forbid you to marry Edvard. He is nothing, has nothing, and writes music that no one will listen to.
I'll go and pack.
Nina.
I'm sorry, Mother. I'm going.
How are you?
Oh, I don't know. Hey, Lorraine, don't lose it, whatever you do.
Oh,
we must go.
No, no, first we must have champagne.
Champagne now?
Yeah. We'd have champagne before the ceremony. Fortitude.
strength to walk up that aisle? Then we have champagne after the ceremony to give you fortitude, give you strength to... for a long and happy life. Skål. Skål.
Now we must hurry.
Here's a letter for you.
Thank you. Take care of the minister. Yes. Don't be nervous.
I'm not nervous.
Dearest Edvard, since I returned to Karlshamn, I've written you a dozen letters. They're all in the waste paper basket. It is all so complicated that I won't even now try to explain things, except to tell you that my father has died. And if you've heard about my engagement to Captain Hansen, it is now off. I've been wondering if it is too late to take up where we left off. I've inherited a sizable fortune and can give you your trip to Rome and can help launch your career.
Mr. Bjornsson. Mr. Nordreck and Mr. Grieg are due today.
Today?
Yes. You agreed with the appointment by letter, remember?
Oh, dear. I hate to break the bad news. I know what this post meant to Grieg.
I wonder why the board was so insistent on giving it to Mr. Henner.
Politics, sheer politics. Talent has very little to do with artistic achievement these days. What time are they due?
About 10.
Good morning.
You work, you worry, you huff, you hurry, your life is a chore. Before you know it, you're old and show it, your life is a bore. Let this happen, friend. Upturn your downward trend. You still have youth in you. Unbend and let it through. Go bounce a ball against a wall some fine morning. Be a boy again. Good morning. Go climb a tree or two, you'll find a clearer view. Go catch a fish once more, you'll feel your spirit soar. Go roll a hoop with a hoop.
take a hike again, ride on a bike again, pilch some forbidden fruit, swim in your birthday suit, don't fly a kite to the height of a high heaven.
Housewarming gift.
Oh, how nice.
Let me open it.
Thank you, sir.
Ribbon.
Good heavens.
No, this is just the thing to give your house that homey touch.
Oh.
Now, we've got to find a place to put it. Here. How about here? Right by the stove.
How about in the stove?
Ho, ho, ho.
Yeah.
Ah. Relative?
Fortunately, no. It came with the house.
Yeah. How's that?
Well, at least it's an improvement.
So, we must be going. Where's Edvard, anyway?
He's upstairs. His piano arrived today. You know, Edvard can't compose if anyone's listening to him. So, he's using the back room. Edvard, hurry down. You're going to be late.
Coming.
All your troubles will be over as soon as we've talked to Bjornsson.
Oh, I hope so.
I'll buy a bottle of wine. This'll be the night to celebrate.
Great.
Hello.
Come, Edward. Let's go. Hurry.
Now, you must understand, Edward, that ability counts for very little in this town. Everything's politics. Who you know, who you are.
What are you trying to say?
That I pleaded Edward's case as eloquently as I know how, because I do believe they could not find a better man for the job. But the board was adamant.
The post has already been given to another man.
Johan Hennem.
This is irony for you. Why do you suppose a musician with all Edvard has to offer even considered this ignominious post of yours? I'll tell you, it was out of loyalty to Norway. He hoped he could pound some sense of musical appreciation into the heads of his numbskull countrymen.
Oh, please.
I happen to know for a fact that Edvard turned down an offer of unlimited money to finance a worldwide recital tour of his own, and I can get him a dozen more offers like that.
Oh.
A and B, it's A major, not A flat major. I've told
you 100 times. Keep it simple. And not the pedal, please.
Can find a less violent teacher.
Look, Edvard, I know it's difficult, terribly difficult for you, but if we want to eat, you'll simply have to learn to control your temper.
I can't take it anymore. I just can't take it.
Hello, everybody.
Hello. I'm so busy instructing young ladies who don't even wish to play the piano that I'm left with neither the time the desire for creative work. Hello. How are you? Sit down.
Thank you. I have good news.
Oh?
The Musical Society is going to help you organize 4 subscription concerts.
You mean professional engagements?
Yes, Edvard will have a share in the receipts. You understand it's not going to be much financially, but Edvard, it's going to be such a showcase.
Of course, of course. We'll share it all together.
I may not be here.
What do you mean?
Why?
I have a chance to return to Berlin to continue my studies. And I'm thinking about it.
Don't think. You must go by all means.
I shall feel very forlorn without the two of you.
Well, I don't know what we will do without you. Christiania will seem even worse than it is. But you must take this opportunity.
And I'll only forgive you on one condition.
What's that?
That you stay for the festival.
Midsummer's Eve already. How quickly the year has passed.
It's disgusting, Aunt Ali. Simply disgusting.
Here, in the Christiania Gazette. I have it sent to me. Let me read you this announcement. Edvard Grieg, piano lessons. 2 kroner an hour. He's down to that. With all his talent. Mayor,
Doris, this man's career has become an obsession.
And it always will be.
You must put him out of your mind. He's married to somebody else now.
I'm only too well aware of that, Aunt Ali.
To imagine that this is an exquisite, rare vintage champagne. Here, one for you, and one for you. Oh, sorry.
Thank you.
One for me. Score. I'm sorry.
Wait a minute. I'll put some pepper and oil in it and add it to the salad. Oh, I don't know what we're celebrating. After you've gone tomorrow, a very vital, a very wonderful...
And a bit exhausting.
No, I'm serious, Edvard. A very important part of our lives will be gone.
But I'm coming back. Next Midsummer's Eve.
Mama?
Oh, great! Just what we need, a picture of the three of us.
Oh, wonderful.
Hello, my good man. You'd like to take our picture now, wouldn't you? Over here, I think. Come on. We should make this a Three Musketeers pose. All for one and one for all.
Well, I suppose that's no worse than God bless our happy home.
I'll find my place in the sun with you to guide me.
My darkest battle is won if you're beside me.
Here on our hill of dreams, stand with your hand in mine. I'll find a horizon shining and fair.
Story of three of the North, and the pledge that they all did plight. The tale of a love as unfailing
as the unpaling light of the Norway sun, the sun that shines in the night.
One there was who roamed these hills and thought his thoughts, no one to share them. Till that time he told them all to one he knew, able to dare them. Two there were who, clasping hands then, locked their lives as friend and brother. Who'd imagine two would find a warm and wise and wondrous other? Three there were who roamed these hills and dreamed such towering, tall dreams. Three there were who vowed they would be always, always.
my goodbye.
But like the midnight sun that never leaves the sky, my heart is one of three, and faithful it will be until I die.
Gentlemen, you're asking that the town council should reduce the rent of the lodge hall. Now, why should they do that, Mr. Green?
Well, frankly, sir, with the present rent you're asking, there'd be a little chance of the council showing a profit.
Do you mean to say, Mr. Green, the sole reason for suggesting these four subscription engagements is to turn a profit for yourself?
Well, it's certainly one of our objectives.
The musical society manages very nicely to conduct its concerts without any personal gain for itself.
Yes, but those gentlemen do not rely on music for a living. They perform on a purely amateur basis.
Still, Mr. Bjornsson, they're regarded here in Christiania as first-rate musicians.
Regardless, my whole life is devoted to music. Isn't.
And because you look upon yourself as a professional, does that justify denying the taxpayers their full revenue for the lodge hall?
Good day, gentlemen.
Do you apply the same yardstick to doctors because of their ability to cure the sick? Or that lawyers should work without recompense because they serve the ends of justice? But one thing is certain. By such an attitude, you are destroying any hope that Norway may have of approaching the artistic level of the other countries in Europe. Yours is a smug, complacent, isolated little world. And a tragedy for Norwegian culture.
No home do I have, no home do I want. There's a whole world for me to wander. No love do I have to tether me down with a smile innocent and tender. I cross the gray mountain of stone. I sail the sullen sea and sail alone. Sail alone, so alone. For the home I had, why the love I had was undone, yes, and put asunder.
Edvard must have this piano.
It is a little jam. I doubt if I ever had a piano with a lovelier tone.
It may take me some time to get the money. I don't know quite how I can manage the deposit.
But if you would drop in occasionally and sing for me as you did today, that would be deposit enough.
I'll have to write to Bergen to arrange the sale of a cottage my father left me. It's been handed down for many generations.
And you're willing to part with something that obviously means so much to you?
I'd do anything to get a decent piano for Edvard. Please don't mention it to him. I want it as a surprise. Mr. Krogstad, how do you suppose the others managed?
Schubert and Liszt, for example?
For example, yes.
Well, both Schubert and Liszt were sponsored by a very influential man, Count Esterházy. Now, if your husband had somebody like that behind him, it would make a difference.
There is one qualification, however, Mr. Bjornsson, that this donation toward the hall rental be kept absolutely confidential.
This is a very kind gesture on your part, Miss Berg.
I only hope it turns out to be a kind gesture.
I don't quite understand.
Perhaps I can best explain my fears by reminding you of what happened to Ole Bull. You know, he was a Norwegian.
Yes. Yes.
I remember hearing him tell Father that at his early recitals in this very city, his largest audience was a few dozen people.
Well, fortunately, the world now recognizes him for the talented violinist he really is.
He was just as talented at his first recitals. But he had to go to Rome to get the acclaim he deserved. And I'm afraid that's exactly where Edvard has to go to build his reputation. Goodbye, Mr. Bjornsson.
Goodbye, Miss Berg. Christmas with us up at Aulestat.
Oh, how kind of you.
It will be a fine way to celebrate, wouldn't it?
Yes, thank you very much.
To see the thing to be is good. At Christmas time.
Christmas time, a kiss needs neither reasoning nor rhyme, for love itself was born upon the morn of Christmas time. For love itself was born upon the morn of Christmas.
At Christmas time, at Christmas time, make merry and rejoice. The wreaths are up, the tinsel hung, the carols in voice. The trees trim, the gooses cooked, and stuffing is sublime.
Fa la 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 la
at Christmas time.
Fa la 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 at Christmas time.
At Christmas time.
This eve of good friends meeting,
to the bond that brings us together, to the fond and fast affection that will long outlast this greeting. Our fire is blazing here for your warmth, our food we offer for your favor, while the wine is yours to savor, and the soft bed after for your sleeping, my toast is merely welcome. This house is saying welcome. This family gives thanks that you have come well to our home.
Now, what have you got there? Oh, what a big book. It's Kittleson's drawings of dwarfs and trolls.
Oh, look at that one.
Tell us about them.
Shall I tell you about the trolls?
Please.
All right. I'll try at the piano. Are you coming with us? Come on. Here we are. Now, let's see.
Tell us about the trolls.
The trolls. Sit there, go back, and I'll tell you about a forest troll. One-eyed forest troll.
They tower above the towering trees and stalk the step of the sinner.
They frequently frown, bend down and seize and eat the poor sinner for dinner.
But children who mind speak truth and are kind
and finish the porridge that's poured in their bowls.
Have nothing to fear from the fiercest of trolls.
Steer clear,
my dears, of trolls. Thank you.
Grieg and I must do an opera together.
An opera?
Yes, why not? Based on legendary characters like Wagner's Rheingold. Only ours will be pure Norwegian.
You can continue with that in the sleigh. Every Christmas we visit the children on the farm.
What do you think of the idea?
I can't think of anything but an opera. It all depends on you. You're the only Norwegian who can do the music.
I feel honored. As soon as you write the libretto, I'll start on the music.
Bring it!
And wrappings and trinkets and toys, whistles and wagons and hammers for boys, purses for pockets and lockets for girls. Sugared apples, candy canes, bows and arrows, wind-up trains, nuts and dates and kites and skates, and dimpled dolls with golden curls.
Sugared apples, candy canes, bows and arrows, wind-up trains, nuts and dates and kites and skates, dimpled dolls with golden curls.
Sigrid and something for Paul, something for sister and something for all. Ribbons and wrappings and tea sets and tops, something that bounces and something that hops, something that tinkles and something that twirls.
Sugared apples, candy canes,
bows and arrows, wind-up trains,
nuts and dates and kites and skates and dimpled dolls with golden curls.
Sugared apples, candy canes, bows and arrows, wind-up trains, nuts and dates and kites and skates and dimpled dolls with golden curls.
Especially the music. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Good night. Nina, you are magnificent.
Thank you, Mr. Krogstad. I'll be able to pay for the piano in a few days. The cottage has been sold.
Well, it's sad to make such a break with the past.
You mustn't let this disappointing attendance discourage you, Edward.
The audience loved you.
Oh, thank you.
I'm afraid the people of Christiania have to be educated to classical music.
Well, all the bold play right here in this very theater, a program of all classical music. And he drew such a large audience that they had to schedule a second performance the following night.
But the people know Ole Bull.
Well, Ole Bull has a reputation.
Right. A reputation that he acquired first in Rome, then Paris, Leipzig, Vienna. Not in Christiania.
Teresa! May I introduce my wife, Krogstad Bjørnson?
I've had the pleasure of meeting Miss Berg.
Miss Berg? Oh, this is your friend from Sweden you spoke so much about.
Yes. Actually, I'm in great debt to Miss Berg. She was responsible for my first recital.
Mr. Krogstad and the Bjørnsons are dropping by for coffee. Would you join us, Miss Berg?
Oh, please come.
Yes, please do.
Thank you. Of course, all of this is just temporary until we get to Rome.
You're going to Rome?
Quite soon, I hope.
You mean they're finally coming through with Edward's grant?
Well, not quite. I'm afraid Nina's a little optimistic.
No, I'm not. And I'm sure the town council will give it to him, just as soon as we get the letter we've been expecting from Franz Liszt.
Franz Liszt?
He's heard your music?
Well, I don't know. It's just that a friend of mine...
Magdalena Torreson.
Yes, a most important influence.
Yes. Mm. Well, anyhow, she wrote to a friend of hers in Rome and asked him to show one of my pieces to Liszt.
It does sound to me as though you're building your hopes rather prematurely.
Tell me, Edward, what have you written recently?
He composed a beautiful violin and piano sonata, the one being shown Liszt.
But Edward wrote that in Denmark.
Where can I get a copy of the sonata?
I'm afraid I haven't found a publisher yet.
Oh. But certainly you've written other things since then.
Nothing, absolutely nothing.
But he's been very busy.
Giving piano lessons to young ladies.
By the way, where is your piano?
It's upstairs, in his studio.
Can I have a look at your studio?
Yes, why not? Will you excuse me? I'm afraid that delightful ditty stretches the ability of even my best pupil.
Oh, Edward.
Edward, this will never do. I just can't watch a talent like yours wither in this miserable room.
Well, as Nina said, we do have things in the wind.
Things in the wind. In heaven's name, Edward, please let me help you. Accept the offer I made in that letter.
I don't know. Well, it's extremely kind of you.
If it makes it any easier for you, Edward, you could consider it a business loan. And one day, when you're on your feet, you can pay it back. Even with interest, if you want.
It's very tempting.
Within a month, you can be having your first recital in Rome. Just sitting in the bank doing nobody any good. And don't be a fool, Edward.
Hello, dear.
Hello.
Where's Bjørnson?
They've just left.
Well, it's getting late. I must be leaving too.
So, there you are, Mr. Krogstad. The full amount.
Thank you, madam. I must admit, it isn't very often that I sell a piano this expensive. Not here in Christiania. I'm sure you'll be very happy with it.
Oh, it's not for me. It's for a friend. Here's the gentleman's name and address. I'll expect you to deliver the piano to him as soon as possible.
Good day, Mr. Krogstad.
Good day.
I've just been down to the Lodge Hall. Financially, our concert was a disaster.
Oh. A present came for you today.
Oh?
It's in your studio.
Did you hear what a difference a really fine instrument can make?
Yes. It's beautiful. It's a gift from Teresa Berg.
Yes, I assumed as much. Oh, it's beautifully made.
Miss Berg appears to be a very generous woman.
Yes, and a very wealthy one.
Wealthy or not, surely you wouldn't accept such an expensive gift from this woman?
Why not? You know how desperately I needed this piano.
Yes.
How vital it is to my work. Well, the money means nothing to Teresa. And this piano, it means everything to me. Well, you tell me then, how else should I get a grand piano like this?
There's no other way. You could get a grand piano like this.
Oh.
Don't you know that Teresa is in love with you?
You're imagining that.
Oh, I only wish I were, Edward.
Nina, please. Nina, listen. Teresa's interest has nothing to do with love. She just wants to help my career. And if a year ago I hadn't been such a fool, I wouldn't now be reduced to teaching the piano instead of playing it in concert hall. About an offer from Teresa to set up recitals in Paris, Rome, wherever I wanted.
She made you such an offer?
Yes. And if I'd accepted, I wouldn't be mired here in Christiania, groveling for a living. My career would have been assured.
But based on a woman paying your way? Edvard, would you have wanted that?
By heaven's sake, Nina. Be realistic. Would you prefer that I go on with this wasted, unproductive life? Even though I can't compose anymore? Can't even think? Nothing ahead? A frustration? Hey? I've got to get out. I've got to think.
I've tried to rationalize. It's
tell myself not to worry. It'll all work out. The usual things.
Still deep down, you knew he was right. That's so, isn't it?
Well, it's as Edvard said. There's nothing ahead for him here but disillusionment and failure.
Still, no wife could be expected to tolerate a husband who's living out the sufferance to another woman.
And she's in love with Edvard. He could be a very famous composer, Mr. Krogstad, if only given the chance.
Yes, and not given the chance. His resentment toward you would grow by the day. I can see that.
And could you blame him? Could you really?
Well, I wish it were possible for me to say no. But I realize how I would have felt 50 years ago. You see, once I aspired to be a concert pianist.
Oh, I didn't know.
Only I didn't have a Count Esterházy or a George Sand.
Or a Teresa Berg.
Well, there it is. Nearly all of them had somebody with influence behind them.
Thank you, Mr. Krogstad.
Hello. I'm sorry the way I talked to you.
It's all right, dear. I understand.
I've been fighting this thing out. And I've found only one answer.
Please. Please don't give me that answer just yet. A letter came for you while you were out. Read it first.
It's from Liszt. No, so much depends on you to be ready for it.
Sir, I am happy to tell you of the sincere pleasure I derived from reading your sonata. It proves that you have a talent for composition which is spirited, thoughtful, original, and of a quality so excellent that it can only follow its natural course and ascend to the highest rank.
I am confident that you will find in your country the success and the encouragement you deserve, and which you will certainly not find lacking elsewhere. If you go to Rome this winter, I most warmly invite you. Let me assure you, Mr. Grieg, of my admiration and offer you my most sincere good wishes. 29th of December, 1868, Rome.
F. Liszt. When Franz Liszt writes in this manner, we can all recognize that Edvard Grieg's music is being accepted by perhaps the most distinguished musical authority of our day.
The request has been submitted on behalf of Mr. Grieg that he be given a travel grant, enabling him to make a journey to Rome. We will put it to the vote.
Those not in favor, please rise. There are 8 men standing and 8 men seated. Mr. Chairman, would you exercise your casting vote?
Grant is awarded.
Congratulations, you got your grant.
Oh, that's wonderful, wonderful. Oh, it was agony waiting.
I'm very happy for you, Edvard. I suppose you'll be leaving for Rome soon?
Tomorrow.
Tomorrow? That quickly?
What about you, Therese?
I'm becoming restless. I may tour Europe.
Will that include Rome?
Possibly.
Nina! Nina, we won!
Yes, we've won.
Oh, it's glorious! Oh,
you're determined to leave tomorrow, I'd better start packing your things.
Well, it's just a matter of a short while, Nina. The minute I get settled, I'm sending for you.
Of course, darling. You said you were going to stop off in Berlin on your way.
Yes.
If Rickard isn't well, as his letters indicate, you really should see him.
Of course. But don't worry about him. He'll be on his feet before I get there. Now, please tell me, how much is the grant? I asked you, how much is the grant?
I'm afraid it's not quite what we expected.
Well, exactly how much is it?
Edvard, it's very cold in here. Would you see if the fire's gone out?
Yes, of course.
Perhaps it's just as well it's happening this way.
What are you talking about? For the last time, how much is the grant?
50 kroner.
A week?
A month.
A month? Oh. Must be had enough. We need to make a trip alone. They know I have a wife to support.
Oh, the grant doesn't include a wife. Edvard, they're firm on that point.
Oh, that's ridiculous. They're still in session with them. Straight down.
Edvard! Please. It's for the best.
For the best? How can it be for the best?
Edvard, I'm going back to Elsinore.
You're what?
This is very difficult for me. I've wanted to tell you before, but I just haven't had the courage. All this matter about the grant had just made it easier for me.
You're unhappy with me?
Oh, no, Edvard, darling. Well, you've been a wonderful husband.
I'll admit that life hasn't been much fun lately. I know. Well, I do have a few things.
No, it isn't that. You see, I don't have to live like this. I mean, I have a comfortable home in Elsinore, and my parents want me back. I'm tired of all this struggling. I've grown to hate this place. It's cold, it's dismal, it's unfriendly. I hate it.
I know how you feel. I feel that way myself sometimes. And I love you. I love you very much.
But I just have to get away from here.
All right, you go back. You go back home. But you make it sound forever.
Oh, I don't mean to. I'm sure I'll feel differently just as soon as you come back.
Mm.
Look at Rickard. He's such a hopeless sentimentalist, and I love him for it.
Oh, you doctors. Always so grim. I have a heavy cold. I'm going to be out of this bed in 1 week. You wait and see.
Yes, yes. With your attitude. I dare say you will be.
I'll be back in a minute.
Yes.
It was a shock to find him so ill, Doctor. I've been here a week. And, well, I do have to go to Rome now.
Now?
Yes. If Dr. Steinrock will approve.
Prognosis is very difficult when you are dealing with tuberculosis. I'm not sure how long his strength can withstand the illness.
Yes, I see. I'll be back in about 2 weeks.
I wouldn't make it any longer than that, Mr. Great.
Pardon me, Mr. Glick, but if you do say to Mr. Nordrock that you will return in 2 weeks, please, keep your promise.
You can count on it, Mrs. Smith. Hello.
Hello.
I told the doctor I'd be back in 2 weeks. Well, just as soon as I met with List.
If you can, fine. You really mean that, Edvard?
Yeah, my way.
We have so many plans for Norwegian music.
And I promise we'll carry them through, you and I.
Good morning, Mr. Grieg.
Good morning.
Oh, by the way, one of our members left word that if you came in, he'd like to see you.
Oh, who?
Mr. Ibsen.
Henrik Ibsen?
Mm-hmm. Oh.
Good morning, Ibsen.
Ah, it's you, Grieg. Excuse me. Let's go somewhere we can talk.
Yes.
I've just learned that you've become a member of our club.
Yes, a few days ago.
What brings you to Rome?
Well, I'm hoping to meet Franz Liszt.
Well, they say if Liszt gets behind the young musician, his career is assured.
Yes.
But I wouldn't count on seeing him too soon. I imagine he's a pretty busy man.
No, I found that out.
Do you play?
Yes. Well, I think so. I haven't played it for some time.
I wanted to talk to you about my play, Peer Gynt.
Oh, yes, that's a marvelous play.
I've decided to make the play with music. Would you be interested in composing the score?
Of course. Oh, yes, thank you very much, Miss Reeves.
Good. I'll have to make a few revisions first, of course, but I could let you have the manuscript in a week or two.
That soon?
Oh, yes. You'd have to start on it right away. And you could count on it taking you a year or more. It's your move.
Unfortunately, in the convivial spirit of Christmas, I've promised to write the music for an opera.
Promised whom?
Well, certainly no one as important as you, Mr. Ibsen.
Then why are you hesitating?
Well, it's a friend of mine, and he's working on the libretto now. Although, as a matter of fact, I haven't received it yet.
Well?
All right. I'd be delighted to start on the music as soon as you're ready for me.
Good.
His landlady added this postscript. Dr. Steinrück has written to Mr. Nordrup's father, asking him to come immediately. Apparently has never been in greater danger than now. And may I remind you of your promise to Mr. Nordrup to return in 2 weeks. He's been counting on your words. Mrs. Schmidt, I've got to leave at once.
Darling, I understand how difficult this must be for you. But you just can't postpone your appointment with Liszt. You've waited this long. You can surely remain another 6 days.
I don't know.
But of course Rickard understands that it takes time to arrange a meeting with a man like Liszt, and what it means to you.
I put all that in 20 letters. They're all in the waste basket. It's hard to tell your best friend that your career comes before him.
In spite of my illness, my heart is still full of the sounds of the North. Pray to God you'll come soon. That we may work together toward the great goals we share.
And I thank your kind letter for my being in Rome. On the strength of your reply, I received a government grant. But this sonata is for piano and violin.
Mr. Grieg and I will play it together. I'll be the violin. Take a stool, Mr. Grieg.
years back.
Thank you very much. Well, hello, Mr. Krogstad. What brings you to Italy?
Who knows? As a matter of fact, I waited over an extra 3 days to attend your concert.
I'm flattered.
Now I can give Nina a first-hand report. In person.
You are returning by Helsingør?
No, I'm going directly to Christiania.
Well, I don't understand. Nina is living in Helsingør.
No. Nina is living in your own home in Christiania. She never left.
Not my letters?
They were forwarded.
What could she be living on?
The money she received from her father's cottage. She sold it.
No, Nina said that nothing in the world would make her part with that cottage.
Except to buy you a piano, Mr. Grieg. I was holding it until the money came.
Piano? She was buying a piano for me.
If I'd only known, I would never have...
It's not as grand as the one that you bought here, Miss Berg. But Nina's had a heart.
Here's the list. Nearly everyone from the Scandinavian Club has accepted. It'll be a wonderful party.
A gala celebration, I take it.
Yes, that was the idea.
Mr. Grieg has much to be proud of.
As a little after-dinner surprise, I have taken the liberty of giving the orchestra the music for Solveig's song. Teresa, I had hoped that you would sing it for us.
No, I can't do that. I'm so sorry, but I couldn't do it justice.
Please, Teresa. But we can't go without singing our anthem.
Do you know who wrote our anthem? The words are by Björnson and the music by Rickard Nordrup.
Yes, we love him.
Willful obsession can take hold of someone. How it can blot out every thought but one. You see, I had convinced myself that it would be only through my money that your genius could be given to the world. All my money bought was heartaches for everyone. I
believe in your success tonight. You can thank your talent for that.
Oh, thank you.
And all that round of friends at parties? All a bid for reflected glory. Well, there you have it.
I think you're a marvelous woman. And I admire you very much.
Still, it's Nina you love.
Yes. It's from Björnson. It's the libretto for his opera. He obviously sent it before he received my letter regarding it. I've let everybody down.
Edvard Grieg. I am Richard Nordreich's father.
Oh. How is he?
My son is dead.
No.
My son died with a deep sadness in his heart. I can assure you, Mr. Grieg, I did not come to see you of my own free will. And it is my fervent hope that you and I never again meet. Richard tore this particular page from his diary. It was his last request that I give it to you. This may have been the most important day of my life. It is the day I met Edvard Grieg in the Tivoli Gardens. Together we share a great and beautiful ideal. For our goal is the establishment of a purely Norwegian music. My son was a sentimentalist. He was also an optimist. He thought you really meant what you said. Good day, Mr. Grieg. Excuse me, madam.
Bye, Edward.